Okay. So I think everyone can see the slides. Okay, so first, on the first lecture, I explained what superintegrable systems are and their relation to Liouville systems. So as I was explaining, the superintegrable systems are integrable systems where Liouville tori have dimension less than n. So it's sometimes it's possible to refine a Liouville integrable system by a superintegrable system, where n-dimensional Liouville tori, as a result of this refinement, will be fibered by, say, k-dimensional Liouville tori for the corresponding superintegrable system. And we saw the example of this. It's a Kepler system. It's a superintegrable system, maximally superintegrable system, in the sense that all compact trajectories are periodic. But on the other hand, it's also an integrable system in the six-dimensional phase space. So if you just know about the integrability of this system, well, you actually know very little about the nature of the system, where you know that the motion is always just, you know, one-dimensional in the phase space. Okay, so that's the idea of superintegrability. It's, I mean, probably the most intuitive way to think about it is that this is a refinement of Liouville integrability. So today we will discuss superintegrable systems that can be constructed on moduli spaces of flat G connections over a surface. So these are our moduli spaces. So here G is connected, simply connected Lie group. It doesn't have to be, but you may think about a compact Lie group. So sigma is an oriented compact surface with n components of the boundary. And say if we have a torus, with one component of the boundary. Sometimes I will call it puncture if I'm not careful. But the reason for this is that what we really need is the fundamental group of the surface with one component of the boundary, which is the same as the fundamental group for a surface with puncture. Okay, so the moduli space is the moduli space of flat G connections on a principal G bundle over sigma. And I'll assume that this bundle is trivial. Actually, it's always trivializable when there is no boundary. And if there is a boundary, then it's still more or less the case. So the other way to think about this moduli space is the so-called the character variety. These are the conjugacy classes of representations of homomorphisms from pi 1 g to g, or representations of pi 1 g in g. Okay, so it's well known since the classical work of Atiyah and Bott. And by classical here, I mean really like classics, not classical mechanics. So I will just remind the logic of the paper, but of course I will not give the details. So let's fix this principal G bundle over sigma. So I'm deriving the symplectic structure on this moduli space when there is no boundary. Again, we trivialize this bundle, it's trivializable. So I assume that it's trivial. So then consider the space of all connections on this principal G bundle. So the space of connections, it's well known, it's an affine space over over the space of forms in over the space of forms. Sorry, it's terribly late for me, so I may be stuttering. It's 10 o'clock here in Beijing. So so it's an affine space over omega one over forms of degree one on sigma with coefficients in the Lie algebra. And because our model is trivial, we have a trivial connection. And because of this, we can identify the connections with forms on sigma, with g-valued forms on sigma. So on the space of, on this infinite dimensional space, and I already got one question about Fréchet spaces. So here, just, you know, let's not go into the analytical details of functional analysis, otherwise we will never leave this space, this particular space in the lecture. So it's an infinite dimensional vector space. At the moment, I will ignore the topological issues, functional analysis issues altogether. So naively, if you think about it, you see that it has a natural skew symmetric form. And so here, dA, you should think of this. So of course, it's a one form on sigma with coefficients in G, but it's also a one form on the space of connections. So this is two form on the space of connections. And we integrate over the sort of two form components on sigma in this wedge product. So here I assume that G is a matrix group, matrix Lie algebra, and the Killing form is simply the trace. It's just more convenient. So here D capital is the Durham differential on the space of forms on the space of connections. So this is what we have. This is what I promised. On the space of connections, on this infinite dimensional vector space, we have a two form, which is naively at least non-degenerate, and it's yes, and it's a two form in the sense of the Durham differential in the space of all forms on this infinite dimensional space of connections. So, as I said, naively it's degenerate. There is a way how to make it more precise, but I'm just outlining the logic of why the character variety, which is a finite dimensional variety, why it should have, why it's natural that it has a symplectic form. Okay. So we have this infinite dimensional vector space, connections, G connections, connections on the principle G bundle on sigma with the symplectic form omega G sigma. But on this infinite dimensional vector space, we also have the action of the infinite dimensional gauge group. So since our bundle is trivial, the gauge group is simply this set of maps from sigma to G, and I'll assume that these are the smooth maps. So the action is the usual gauge action on connections, the way how physicists and mathematicians and everyone understand it. Infinitesimal action is the action of the Lie algebra of so this is the Lie algebra of the gauge group. It's just zero forms on sigma with coefficients in G. And for any functional S, so I can write S belongs to omega zero on the space of connections. For any functional S, the action of the Lie derivative along the vector field of this infinitesimal
transformation. Yes, yes, she did.
Hello? Is everything okay, or?
Well, I would say it's okay, just someone got unmuted by some reason.
Oh, okay.
So it's better if everybody is muted unless they want to wait. So.
Okay. So, so the action of the of this vector field is Hamiltonian. In other words, it's given by the Poisson bracket of the Hamiltonian H lambda with S. And the Hamiltonian H lambda, it's very easy to check that it's given by this formula. Lambda is an element of the Lie algebra, which is a zero form on sigma with coefficients in G. And the curvature is a two form. From the same complex. And the Poisson bracket is just a Poisson bracket for our friend for the symplectic form omega g sigma. So, in other words, we have the Hamiltonian action of the gauge group on the space of connections. So, I just explained it very slowly. So these are the Hamiltonians, which represent this Hamiltonian action. And you can see that it's just a trace of lambda with the curvature. So if you want to do the Hamiltonian reduction, so since the action is Hamiltonian, we have the moment map, mu corresponding to this Hamiltonian action. It's a mapping from the space of connections to the dual space to our gauge Lie algebra. Our gauge Lie algebra is omega zero sigma g. So the dual space naturally is the space of two forms, and the pairing between g and g dual is just the integration over sigma. So the moment map itself is given by this formula. It just follows immediately from this structure of the Hamiltonian. And so when we have a Hamiltonian action of a Lie group on a manifold, we can do the Hamiltonian reduction. I mean, the standard, the general Hamiltonian reduction would be we take a coadjoint orbit and then mod it, say, when you have Lie algebra G acting via Hamiltonian vector fields. So we can do this Hamiltonian reduction, we will get symplectic leaves. So these are the symplectic leaves of the if it's sigma of this quotient space. So if we just take the quotient, we will get a Poisson manifold. In this case, it's a horrible infinite dimensional Poisson manifold. So this manifold has symplectic leaves. The symplectic leaves can be obtained through the Hamiltonian reduction in the following way. You take the quadjoint orbit, take its pre-image, take the quotient with respect to the gauge group. That's a symplectic leaf. So in general, coadjoint orbits can be very complicated, but you know that there is a single coadjoint orbit always, it's zero. So that's the standard Hamiltonian reduction. It's this one. There are others, but let's consider this one. So because the moment map is just mapping A to the to its curvature, the inverse, the pre-image of zero, is just a space of flat connections. So this is the space of connections with zero curvature. Just a comment, I mean, one can discuss, it's a beautiful subject, the Hamiltonian reduction, we can discuss it forever. So for example, one of the standard features is that pre-image of zero with respect to the moment map, it's quasi-tropic in the space of connections. And so another way to think about the Hamiltonian reduction is just you're reducing so since it's quasi-tropic, it's also presymplectic, and any presymplectic manifold, you can do the, for any presymplectic manifold, you can do symplectic reduction. So another way to think about the Hamiltonian reduction is that it's a symplectic reduction of this quasi-tropic submanifold. So you can do it one way or the other. The result is that the Hamiltonian reduction of the space of connections is our moduli space. So the moduli space of flat connections. And so because we started, so Hamiltonian reduction of this infinite dimensional symplectic manifold is our moduli space. And it's a fundamental fact about Hamiltonian reductions is that it induces symplectic structure on the result of the Hamiltonian reduction. So that means that MG sigma is symplectic. If everything that we did would make sense, or if it makes sense, then we will have a symplectic manifold. Maybe not manifold, maybe with some singularities, but on a generic neighborhood, it will have a symplectic structure. And that's exactly the theorem of Atiyah and Bott. Basically, it says that everything that we were talking about makes sense, and it can be done in a rigorous mathematical way. And the result is that the moduli space of flat connections has a natural symplectic structure. And it's a very nice result, because, you know, one way to think about this moduli space in terms of this very complicated infinite dimensional symplectic reduction, that way is just to think about this moduli space as a finite dimensional symplectic variety, which is just the character variety for the Lie group G. So the outcome is that this character variety has a natural symplectic structure when the boundary is trivial. Okay, what happens when the boundary is non-trivial? Well, it turns out that similarly, one can show that if the boundary is non-trivial, the moduli space, it's not symplectic, but it's a Poisson manifold. It's, again, there are some singularities, so it's a, strictly speaking, it's a singular Poisson variety. There is a simple description of the Poisson structure on this, on functions on this variety. There are several ways to do it. Say for SLN, for classical Lie algebras, there is a way how Goldman did it through the algebra of path. And there is another way to do it, sort of more general, but maybe less explicit, is in terms of graph functions on these moduli spaces. So the construction of the superintegrable systems that I will be talking about, I think it's better to do it in terms of these graph functions. So I'll just remind what graph functions are. And anyway, they have their own life. It's a very interesting object. So why not to talk about it? So let's consider graphs embedded into sigma with two types of edges. so-called solid-oriented edges and dashed non-oriented edges, which we'll call chords. So now we have our Lie group G. So it has a Lie algebra G. G is simple, matrix. So we will assign to each solid edge a finite dimensional representation of G. It doesn't have to be irreducible. It just has to be finite dimensional. So then if you change V to its Q, then it's equivalent to changing the orientation on the graph. And to a chord, to a dashed edge, we assign the adjoint representation of G. So adjoint representation is isomorphic to the coadjoint representation, since our G is simple. We have the Killing form, which gives this isomorphism. So these are the edges. The vertices of these graphs, now the graphs are embedded, so we have cyclic order of edges adjacent to this, to each vertex because of the embedding, but let's choose also total ordering that is in agreement with the cyclic ordering induced by the embedding. So then alpha is just an invariant tensor, G invariant vector in this tensor product. So here plus is for the incoming edges and minus for the outgoing edges, and V plus is V, V minus is V dual. So these are the kind of solid vertices. And then we'll also have the vertices where chords are connected to solid edges. So remember that chords are colored by adjoint representations. Solid edges are colored by finite dimensional representations. So at each vertex where chord is attached to a solid edge, the representation at the solid edge is not changing. It's the same representation. So to this vertex, we will assign the structural homomorphism. So remember that V is a representation. So V is a representation of G. And when I say V is a representation of G, it's cheating. I mean, it's cheating that everyone is doing. But in fact, any representation is a pair. It's a vector space and a homomorphism from the Lie algebra to endomorphisms of V. So when we say representation, we always have this map. But now let's look at what this mapping is. It's a mapping from G, which is the adjoint representation of the Lie algebra, to V tensor V dual, which is the endomorphisms of V. And so this is what we assign to this vertex. In terms of matrix elements, it's just simply the following. Let's choose a basis in V and an orthonormal basis E sub A in G. And then to this vertex with indices at the end of the edges corresponding to the basis, we will assign just matrix elements of the action of the basis in the Lie algebra in the representation V. Okay, so now we have invariant vectors assigned to vertices. And then if we have a connection, we can take holonomies along edges. So So you also can think of this holonomy as a vector is in V tensor V dual. So, I mean, holonomy is evaluated in representation V. So what you can do is you can pair these vectors with these vectors. And that's what the graph function is. And here I assume that, say, gamma is a smooth embedding. So for a smooth embedding, for a connection A, you can construct this number. So we have a function on the space of connections for every gamma. So here the examples. So if we have a graph like this, colored by representations V1, V2, V3, with two vertices colored by vectors alpha and beta, then the corresponding function is the following. You take matrix elements of the holonomy along edge E1, same for the second edge, same for the third edge, and then you contract them with the invariant tensors that you assign to vertices. So this is in case when you have solid edges. If you have one chord, then it's the same construction. You take holonomy along E1, evaluated in the representation V. So now we have only one representation V. And you take holonomy along the edge E3, evaluated in the same representation, and then contract it with the invariant tensors that are in these vertices. And then you shouldn't forget about the holonomy along the chord. That's the holonomy in the adjoint representation. Okay, so it's a little bit messy definition, but that's what it is. And so what can we say about the graph functions? First, these graph functions are invariant with respect to the gauge, action of the gauge group. That's easy, because when you take a holonomy along some path on sigma, this holonomy transforms in such a way that you have one element of the gauge group corresponding to this point acting, say, on the left side of the holonomy, the other element acting on the right side of the holonomy. And because the vectors corresponding to vertices are G-invariant, it's obviously gauge-invariant. So if it's not obvious, then it's a nice exercise. So these are gauge invariant functions. It means that f gamma is a function on the appropriately understood this quotient space. When you take connections, modulo the action of the gauge group. So we already know that connections, the space of connections is a symplectic, infinite dimensional symplectic space. The action is Hamiltonian. That means that it preserves the symplectic structure. So the quotient space is most likely singular, but it has a Poisson structure on the regular pieces. So it's a Poisson. So F gamma functions on the Poisson space. So that means that there is a Poisson bracket between these functions that's determined by the symplectic structure omega. So what else? If our connection is flat, then the holonomy doesn't depend on deformations, on continuous deformations of the path. And as a result, the graph functions evaluated on a flat connection, they depend not just on gamma, but they depend on the regular isotopy class of gamma. So you can continuously deform this embedded graph. The value of the function doesn't change if the connection is flat. And the third, probably the most non-trivial property, is that these functions, they span the space of functions on the moduli, on the moduli space, in case when G is an algebraic group. So let's say a fine algebraic group. So these are the graph functions as functions on the moduli space of flat connections on sigma. So now, why do we need them? Because the Poisson bracket has very nice structure in terms of this function. So it's the classical result also by Goldman, where he described these functions for the case when representations are vector representations of the of classical Lie algebras. So here G is classical. So here classical means of type A, B, C, D, classical simple Lie algebras. So then with Anderson and Matisse, we had some kind of more general description. I think it was done in our paper. It was kind of a popular subject at the time. So I'm never sure who did it first, but you know, probably somebody can correct me. So, okay. So the theorem is the following. Since our functions are functions in the moduli space, so let this bracket be the Poisson bracket for the Atiyah-Bott symplectic structure on the moduli space. Then this is the Poisson structure. So Anton yesterday, he already introduced this Poisson structure for classical Lie algebras. I'll remind it later. But in general, it's the following procedure. So you have two isotopic classes of graphs, gamma one and gamma two. Choose representatives of these graphs, which intersect nicely, transversally, at a finite number of points. So then the bracket is equal to the sum over the intersection points. So this is the orientation of the intersection. So because the surface is oriented, you know which one is on the left, which was on the right. So I gave this rule over here. So this graph is obtained from gamma one and gamma two by gluing an extra chord next to the intersection point. So this is a representative of this isotopic class. But then when you take the isotopic class, it doesn't matter where you put this chord. It's just what matters is that you put it somewhere in a small vicinity of the intersection point. So when the surface is, when there is no boundary, when the surface is closed, it follows directly from the Poisson bracket corresponding to our friend, the symplectic structure on the space of all connections. So it's an easy proof. Well, it's not an easy proof, but it's with all you know now, it's a straightforward exercise. So what Goldman did in 86 is he took a vector representation of one of the classical Lie algebras. And well, essentially he observed that in this case, when you put the chord inside, so what is this? So it's a vector in V tensor V tensor V dual tensor V dual. And it's a G invariant vector in this space. And then just from the general invariant theory, if you will count the number of invariant vectors in this space, you'll discover that there are two for SLM. And then if you will do more precise computation, you will discover that this tensor, this particular, when you insert the adjoint representation, say, it can be written as the permutation plus the identity, minus the identity operator. So this is the reason for the formula that Anton gave yesterday. So here you have the orientation of lines, because for SLM, the vector representation is not isomorphic to its dual. But if you do the same thing for the orthogonal and symplectic algebras, where the representation is isomorphic to its dual, you also discover that there are three invariant tensors. And it's a nice exercise, just if you will take this particular vector in the, now it will be in V to the fourth. Now we don't have the orientations. So then there are, in this case, there are three invariant vectors. And so a nice exercise is to compute these coefficients. And then if you will compute these coefficients, you will sort of be one step closer to complete understanding of what of Goldman's work from that time. So then I'll just make a proclamation that the same bracket defines Poisson structure on all moduli spaces. It doesn't matter whether it's the surface is closed or not. It's just if it's closed, it's very easy to, again, not very easy, but it's easy to just to derive it from the Poisson, from the symplectic structure on the space of connections. If not, then you derive it from the Poisson structure on the space of connections when the surface has a bound. Okay, so now surface has n component of the n connected components of the boundary. We have the Poisson manifold, the moduli space of flat connections. So it has symplectic leaves, and symplectic leaves are given in order to get symplectic leaves, you just have to fix the conjugacy classes of holonomies around the boundary components. And once you fix them, that's a symplectic leaf. So at the end of the day, after this long discussion, we arrived to these symplectic manifolds. They are singular, they are mildly singular. So they have orbifold type singularities. And I think it was Ezra Gessler who told me that these singularities should be completely ignored. So I'm ignoring them all my conscious life. So now let's construct superintegrable systems on these phase spaces. The construction is very simple. So as a first step, let's choose K non-intersecting, non-self-intersecting curves such that these curves are not contractible to the bound. So here's an example of good choices. So this is good. They are not contractible. And this is kind of meaningless. It's contractible. So when you move it to the boundary, the holonomy around the around this curve will be just the same as the holonomy around the boundary. And we fixed it. So it will be, so the corresponding invariant function will be just the Casimir of the of this Poisson manifold, which is fixed by fixing the conjugacy class. Okay, so now we have the following Poisson subalgebras. In the space of all functions on the moduli space on our phase space, we have the subalgebra functions spanned by graph functions, which do not for graphs. So these are graph functions for graphs. Gamma non-intersecting these curves C1, CK. And then in this subalgebra, we have another subalgebra. These are graph functions for graphs that are contractible to these curves. By contractible, I mean this. You can place your graph gamma into some kind of color, which you can deform into, which you can collapse to C, to one of the contours. So clearly it's a subalgebra, and clearly it's a Poisson commutative subalgebra, because if you have two such graphs, you can always separate them. You can always, you remember that graph functions, they depend only on isotopic classes of these graphs. So you can deform two such graphs and make them separate, so they will have no intersection points. So they will Poisson commute. Also, for the same reasons, this algebra is the, I mean, it's a subalgebra in the center, in the Poisson center of this algebra, because you can always separate any graph from here, from graph from corresponding to this subalgebra, because all these graphs you can contract to our contours C1, Cn. So once we choose these contours, we have the we have these subalgebras. So it's not enough for superintegrability, although we know that this is a commutative Poisson commutative subalgebra. We know that it's subalgebra in the center of this Poisson algebra. What we don't know is whether this is the whole center and what is the balance of dimensions, whether it's enough for superintegrability. It turns out that everything works. It's indeed a superintegrable system. So first statement is that this Poisson commutative subalgebra is really the whole Poisson center of our algebra J. That the dimensions have the right balance. So if you think about I and J as functions on corresponding Poisson varieties, then sum of these dimensions is the total dimension of our symplectic space. And also there is a refinement. So if you will choose just one of these contours, then it's still a superintegrable system, which has only rank Poisson commuting integrals. And this superintegrable system refines all superintegrable systems that I mentioned here, in a sense that invariant tori of these superintegrable systems will be fibered by this r-dimensional tori for each of the contours C1, CK. So it means that really the most interesting case is when we have just one of those contours. Okay, so now geometrically, I think I overstated. I didn't want to make such a strong statement, just got carried away. So now let's look at the geometry of this. So I described this superintegrable system algebraically. You see that the description is almost trivial. You just choose these contours C, and then it immediately gives you these three Poisson solutions. So now let's just look at what it means geometrically for k equals one. So we have our surface sigma. So we choose some contour C. Now what we can do is we can cut our surface along C. And this gives the Poisson variety, which is actually the moduli space of G flat connections on sigma minus C. So it just means that, but then we can project it further to holonomies around, to conjugacy classes of holonomies around this C. So you can see that if you fix the conjugacy class here, let's say this is P2, P1, then P2 inverse of the conjugacy class is a symplectic submanifold here. It's just a moduli space of flat connections on sigma minus C, where you fix holonomies around conjugacy classes around these new components of the boundary when you cut the surface along sigma. And you know, if it's not separating cycle, then you fix the holonomies in such a way that they are the same on the result of the cutting. If it's a separating cycle, then it's the same thing. Okay, so this is the geometric meaning of this of these superintegrable systems. And now I want to say what will be happening next time, and maybe ask if someone have questions about all this. So let me just make a summary. So I gave an outline of, or rather explanation, why these moduli spaces have symplectic structure, why they naturally have symplectic structure and Poisson structure. And then I constructed these superintegrable systems. Okay, so what will happen next time? So next time I'll look at some examples. So we will see that if you have a torus with one boundary component, this gives the model known in mathematical physics and the theory of integrable systems. These are so-called relativistic spin Ruzinar-Schneider models. So then it's easy to generalize these systems to more punctures on torus. When the conjugacy classes assigned to punctures have rank one, then this is sort of, yeah, this is the system that Chalif and Feyerman studied. Maybe not exactly in this context, but they constructed some integrable systems. It turns out that these are exactly the systems. But the thing about these systems is that they are obviously Liouville integrable systems. And this superintegrability is sort of a refinement of this Liouville integrable systems. Okay, so this is what's going to happen next time, but I just want to say a few more words to conclude this lecture. So I was talking about graph functions that are based on chord diagrams. But then you can see that in this formula for the Poisson brackets, in this formula, you can sort of forget about functions. And you can think about this Poisson bracket as the Poisson bracket on the isotopic classes of graphs themselves. So that will, that's, that generalizes this Poisson structure on the space of on the space of loops that Goldman also constructed and discussed. So let's consider the following. Let's consider embeddings of these graphs, the same graphs as I was discussing earlier, with one difference. There are no representations attached to this, to the edges of this graph. So now these are just graphs, and not just graphs, but also the isotopic classes of these graphs. But we will take the quotients of the space of these graphs over the ideal generated by so-called 4T relations. So these 4T relations involve two chords and three solid lines. And so we are quotient by this, by the ideal, such that in the quotient you have this, these relations. So these relations, they appear naturally if you think about this, if you think about invariant tensors. So this is some kind of Jacobian identity for invariant tensors. But you can also think about them just abstractly in terms of graphs. And the reason for this is that you can have these Jacobian identities for kind of increasing sequence of SLN. And so, you know, then if N is very large, then everything is stabilizing. And you basically have these identities for graphs. So they first appeared in the theory of kind of finite type, not invariants in the works of Vasiliev and in the work of Dror-Bernatan, who studied perturbation theory for quantum transcendence. So then actually it's true that you can take the Poisson bracket between these graphs, between the elements of the chord algebra of chord diagrams. And it satisfies the Jacobian identity, and it defines the Poisson algebra structure on the space where the multiplication is just the disjoint unit. Say you take gamma one, gamma two, and you take gamma one, disjoint union, gamma two. So any Poisson algebra, it's a commutative algebra with the Lie algebra structure, such that Lie algebra structure acts by derivations on the commutative algebra structure. It's very easy to check that this Lie algebra structure acts by derivations here. So again, you can consider the quotient algebra. That's what Goldman did. And then you have the Poisson structure on the space of loops. So then, I don't know, this is a question to the audience. Okay, so we have this infinite dimensional Poisson algebra. We have this finite dimensional construction of integrable systems. Is there any meaningful notion of integrability, superintegrability in this infinite dimensional setting? So I don't know the answer. The only thing I know is that this Poisson algebra has very simple quantization and the most natural quantization. So you can assign to the algebra of chord diagrams on sigma the associative algebra of links, or rather graphs, chord graphs, but now not on the surface, but in the cylinder. And the product is just, you, if you want to multiply one graph by the other, you just place one on the top of the other in this cylinder. That's an associative non-commutative algebra. It's easy to check that, it's not easy to check, but it's not difficult to check that it has certain filtration. If you take the associative graded, then you will be back into this infinite dimensional Poisson algebra of chord diagrams. So this is just a side remark. I think I should stop here. Next time we will continue with this subject. And on the last lecture, I will explain how the quantization of these systems is related to our work with Vladimir Turaev on invariance of three manifolds and corresponding TQFTs. So thank you.
So I think let's think, Kole, for next talk. So are there any questions? Yeah, so Kole, there is a question to you, I guess. Written in chart. May you provide some survey papers or textbooks for the construction of golden bracket, Hort graphs, etc.? So that's the.
I should. I should, but I don't know. Maybe Anton knows. Oh, Goldman brackets is just the original paper of Bill Goldman. It's beautifully written paper. It's completely clear. So I would say that. This one doesn't need any review. With chord graphs, it's a little bit more complicated. There are lots of papers where it's mentioned, not mentioned, used, but I don't know a good review. Maybe it doesn't exist. So I don't know, Anton, if you're here, maybe you know some.
I don't know, but what about your paper that you already referred to? Right, I think there are. I mean, kind of. That's not the simplest reference, and I think it's a good reference.
Okay. Actually, I agree. Yes, it's a good paper. So yes. So I forgot where I mentioned it. Somewhere. Yes.
So
it's not a complicated paper. It's. Falk and Rosley, it's a beautiful paper. It definitely has this formula, but the emphasis of the paper by Falk and Rosley is different. I will mention it next time. It's a very nice paper, but it does something more than this. You see, you have the character variety. The one that we discussed, the moduli space, that has a natural Poisson structure. Now, how about the representation variety? If you just take the homomorphisms, but not up to conjugation, just homomorphisms, it's not clear whether this Poisson structure that exists on the quotient can be lifted to a Poisson structure on the space itself. This is still a finite dimensional variety, but it's not obviously Poisson. So what Falk and Rosley did is they basically say that there is a collection of natural Poisson structures there. It depends on what you call natural. To me, it's natural because it's related to Liouville algebra structures on G. And more than this, if you have a graph on the surface, then on the space of so-called graph connections, you also have a natural Poisson structure. And that's another, that's a very combinatorial kind of way to describe the same Poisson bracket. So yes, there is a way how to pass from Fock and Rosley to here, but that's a thing by itself. I wouldn't say that it helps to understand this formula because it involves more information, which is in some sense more valuable than going back to the quotient space. So that's my point of view.
I also don't think there was Hort diagrams in Fock-Rosley.
Probably not, yes.
Okay, so thank you very much, Kolya. If there are no more, there is the next question there. Is it even easy to see that the quotient, Kolya, could you read the comment?
Yeah, is it easy to see that the quotient space is finite dimensional when you allow connections to have arbitrary singularities of functions? Ooh. You see, this is a very nice question, but it goes beyond of what I'm talking about. I was talking about compact surfaces with boundary. So there are no punctures where you can have singularities. But it's a very legitimate question, but I would prefer not to discuss it now. It's late and I'll just say something stupid. I think Anton is-
But the answer exists, yes. So if we fix the order of singularities, then, well, of course it's finite.
Of course, yes. But I think Anton was planning to talk about this. Anton, correct me if I'm wrong.
Sorry, not really, but I can comment on it in my lecture.
Oh, okay. All right. So.
Great. So thank you very much, Kolya. And so we start again in like 10 minutes. So now is 6 minutes past whatever your time zone is. And we restart in 9 minutes, let's say in 15.